Hello and welcome to this session on spatial data analysis, vector and raster. I'm Kapil Obroy. I'm the faculty in the Geoinformatics Department at on spatial data analysis. In this session, we'll cover the following topics. I will quickly review the GIS process flow and also we'll cover the fundamentals of data models, which also lays a good foundation for our this session. Then we'll see the formal definition of spatial data analysis, followed by we'll see the various operations on spatial data analysis, both on the vector and the raster mode. And the final topic for this session will be the comparison of vector and raster-based spatial data analysis operations. Now, to see the GIS process flow, it basically has various stages. So we start with first with the defining of the problem. Let's say the problem could be setting up of a new location or a new facility. Now for the same, first we need to define the criteria. So criteria for establishing a new location could be the proximity to communication route, access, proximity to clients, and other things. Based on the criteria, the next step is we import or create the data sets to support the problem that we want to study. Now, this is where the most of the time goes in the GIS process. Because GIS is an information system wherein we need to provide the necessary data sets for it to process certain information. Once our database is created, the next step is a GIS analysis, which is the beauty of using a GIS, so that at the end we are able to address the problem that we started with. Based on our analysis, we get the output, which in this case could be the suitable sites for setting up the new locations, based on which we take a decision, which could be which one should we pick out of, let's say, the multiple given in the study region. And if we are not happy with the decision, we repeat this process again. But my main motive of putting this slide is that GIS process goes through these various stages. And the advantage, as I said before, is using the power of GIS to help us in answering the question that we are looking for. Now, the other thing that you also know is that in GIS, we could represent the data either in the form of a vector or a raster. So given this infographic on the right-hand side, you can see that there's a real-world phenomena having, let's say, stream, the patches of tree, the house, these three things. Now, to represent this in a raster mode, which is represented using the regular space grid cells, each pixel will be storing the information about the geographic phenomena. So the stream, as you can see it here, could be represented by these series of pixels depending on the spatial resolution. Also, this group of patch of trees could be represented by these pixels and also the patch here on the top left. The house could be represented by the lone pixel. Similarly, in the vector mode, we have three parameters, which are point, lines, and polygon or areas to represent the features. So this stream could be represented by a line. This patch of trees can be represented by a polygon here and also polygon. The house could also be represented by a point feature. But it also depends on the scale we are mapping. So house in depending on the resolution could also be made as a polygon. So it depends on the resolution source. Now the other thing we also know about the vector model is that for each feature, there is an associated feature attribute table linked to that particular phenomenon that we are studying. For example, if these points are the locations, then the attribute could be the name of the location and certain other attributes related to that feature. Similarly, for the line feature, assuming it is a roads, then the attributes could be the name of the road, the type of the road, the speed limit, etc. Similarly, there could be any number of attributes associated with the polygon or the area feature. Coming to the raster, these are ideal for representing the continuous type of phenomena we call as field. So as you know, there are two types of geographic phenomena. That could be object, which is represented good by vector model. And then for the field, we generally use the raster technique. In the raster data, the area is covered by grids. And we also call about the pixels or the picture element, which contains the actual data. Now, from the attribute perspective, are recorded by assigning to each cell a single value. Here we are not talking about that fuzzy concept, wherein each pixel value will contain a single value, which could be the majority features in that particular place. So you can see that the land use type in the vector model is represented by a polygon, but whereas in the raster, you can see this depending on the resolution, each pixel will store an information about the land use type. You can see that this A polygon could be represented by these series of pixels in the raster bank. Now let's come to the spatial data analysis. So we can define it as computing of new information. So it is, in this we are computing the new information that provides new insight from the existing state. So anytime we are trying to relate one spatial phenomena with other, or trying to see one spatial feature in a space or a distance from other features, we are doing the spatial data analysis. But objective is to provide a new insight from the existing data that we have stored so that we are able to solve the problem that we want to study. Now, broadly, we could classify spatial data analysis of two types. It could be either vector-based or raster-based, purely on the base of the data models that are available in a QRS. However, we could also define it, as we will see subsequently in the further slide, on some other categories also, like maybe basic retrieval operations, overlay operations, or neighborhood operations. Now, spatial data analysis is not a new concept. If you refer to the any GIS textbooks, you will come across this classic example of the uses of spatial data analysis. This is in the pre-computer age. So there was an epidemic in Soho district of London, somewhere in 1854. Now, at that time, it was not known that cholera was a waterborne disease. So there was a doctor called Dr. John Snow. In order to convince the authorities that yes, it is a waterborne disease, so which many people were dying, what he did was he created this map, which you can see on the left hand side here. So he plotted the location of the water pump, which you can see from this blue circle, and this red plus, this red dots plus symbol denotes the deaths that has happened due to this mysteriously. Now, once he has prepared this map, the picture is evident now. Or should I say the pattern is also evident. As they say, picture is worth a thousand words. So if you look at it here, most of these deaths due to this mysterious disease were confined in the central region, which happens to be closer to this waterfall. Now this cholera being a waterborne disease, and since these people were drawing water from this waterfall, using this map, he was able to convince the authorities that they should remove the handle from the water pump. The moment they do that, the number of cases come drastically down. So as I said, this is a pre-computer age where he was relating the location of the water pump with the location of the deaths to relate that, yes, these deaths have been caused due to the people drawing water from this. And in the today's age, we have seen that GIS is also being used widely during the COVID time. That could be either in the form of those dashboards that we must have observed while watching the news channels, also in the newspapers, which provide a insight for, and also at a glance kind of a picture of what is happening with a reference to the number of cases, how they are increasing and decreasing with the reference to various regions around the world. The same concept was also being used both at the country level, state level, region level, and also at the continent levels also. Many of the countries started their contact tracing app. For India, we have this Aarogya Setu app, wherein there was a feature provided to check the other patients within your vicinity, let's say 500 meter, 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, and so on. Not only that, there was also a feature in Aarogya Setu where you can look for the testing laboratories. So nearest to your place, where are the official testing laboratories where you can do that testing, and even the directions were also being linked to assist the user to reach to that place. And also, one can also see the number of cases and what is the status and so on. And later on, more capabilities were added about the vaccination and other things were also added. So this slide I just used to tell that your GIS has a broader application and could be used in various scenarios. But the spatial analysis capability is very, very important when you talk about making some decisions and assisting people to help them in various situations. In this case, was a healthcare. Now moving forward, coming to the classification of analysis capability, one way I said we could classify purely based on the data model, which is raster and vector, but we could also classify some of the operations as measurement, retriever, classification, which you have studied in the previous lecture 2 days back. In this session, I will be focusing on the overlay function, where we are looking for combining two or more spatial layers together that could be done in vector or in the raster domain. And we also talk about the neighborhood function or the proximity function, where we try to see the characteristics of a spatial feature or an area surrounding the feature under consideration. Now let's try to understand what we mean by overlay. So the overlay, whenever we are trying to combine two or more layers, it is called as an overlay operation. However, in order to perform the overlay operation, there are certain preconditions. Obviously, first is it requires at least two input layers. That could be in the vector mode or that could be in the raster mode, as you can see from the graphics on the right hand side. Other second point is they should also be in the same georeference system. And third is they should overlap in the study area, because there is no point in overlapping maybe one region which will only be common to other region. So because the system will perform the operations, but the output will be senseless or meaningless if these conditions are not met. So basically what we are trying to do in the overlay is to compare the characteristics of the same location for both the layers. That could be, as I said, vector or the raster. But the output will be a new layer will be created based on the operations that we want to perform. So basically the output of the overlay operation will produce a new output value for each of those locations or features that are in consideration. For pixel, for the raster, it will be cell by cell, and for the polygon, the different regions will be superimposed or one on top of other, depending on the operation that we are performing, maybe intersect, maybe union, some other operation difference, that type of output will be generated. But important is we are trying to overlap one region on top of another and trying to see the generate a new information. Now, before we get into and know about the various vector overlay operations, let's try to cover the basic principles of the vector overlay. So given here are two layers, layer one and layer two, as you can see on this infographic here. Layer one has two polygons, one and two, and in the attribute table, there are two columns, ID and class. In the layer 2, again, there are two polygons, 1 and 2, and the attributes are ID and cost. And these are the instances of those and the polygon values. Now, if I do an overlay, which means if I try to put this on top of this, so if I try to put layer 1 on top of layer 2, as you can see that the new output layer will be created. Now, one thing if you notice is the output layer has more number of features than the input layers. For example, in the layer 1, there were two features, 1 and 2, whereas in the layer 2, again, there are two features. But in the output layer, now we have 4. Now, how these features are created is because if I put this on top of this, wherever those line segments will be intersecting with the geometries or the boundaries of the other polygons, the new geometries will be created. As you can see, this one geometry is being created because if I overlay this on top of this, wherever this segment intersect with this segment, a new polygon has been created. Similarly, these polygons are also being created due to the intersection of the various geometric features in both the input and the output layer. So first thing that you can observe is there are more number of features which are created due to the intersection of geometries between the two layers. But one more thing, if you notice, has happened in the attribute table. If you look at the layer one attribute table or the attribute data, if I say, we have the two fields, ID and class. And similarly, in the layer two, we have an attribute data of ID and cost. Whereas in the output layer, we have three attributes, ID, class, and cost. And if you see this, the class and the cost are inherited from both the layer one and layer two, respectively. So now if you just consider the attribute information, so this polygon one, which is created out of this region one here and region polygon one of the layer two, because of the intersection of the geometry, as I just talked about. But this attributes of class value zero, it is because this this is coming inherited from this attribute information of polygon one, which is zero here. Similarly, the cost is 10. The reason being is because this is the attribute information coming from the polygon one of the layer two, which here the cost is 10 again. Similarly, if you do it for the other, you will be able to understand that. So not only in the overlay, the new geometries are created, but also the attributes informations are also being inherited from the both the layers. We could also have different types of overlay. Let's say the point with the polygon, which we call as a point in a polygon overlay operations. So given here an example of a met station denoted by these point symbols 1, 2, and 3, and the forest polygon map denoted by these two polygons denoting the forest region and the non-forest region. So if I just try to overlay this, then now I can find out these points, which how many of those points are within the forest or outside the forest. But if I just consider them individually, like met station map, then I have no information about whether these features are within the polygon or not. But the moment I integrate or superimpose or overlay this information together, now I can get the picture. Individually, I was not able to have that information. So remember our definition of data analysis, where we say deriving new information to get insight or to generate new information based on the existing stored data. Same here, as we discussed in the previous slide about the overlay operations. If you look at the attribute table now of the met station, apart from the ID field, which is generally system generated, we also have the information about the land use, which is coming from the polygon map, which is the forest and the non-forest. Similarly, we could also have the line in the polygon overlay operations, wherein the line could be overlaid with the forest, and wherever those segments of line will intersect with the geometries of the polygon, the new segments will be created. As you can see from this figure here, that the initial road line map has three lines numbered as 1, 2, and 3, but whereas in the final output, once we do this overlay, now there are five segments of the routes created. This is because of the intersection of the geometries of the line as well with the polygons. And the same thing has happened to the attribute information. For example, now you can see this. This attribute one is having a land use of forest because of the attribute information is fetched from the polygon map here. Similarly, if you look at this segment number five, which you can see it here, that land use information is non-forest because it is lying in this polygon. So once we use the overlay, then the information that was not available to me, if I just consider those layers independently, I'm able to generate a new information based on the existing data. And this you can also relate to the classic GIS stack diagram that you must have observed during the initial lectures, wherein I can derive new information by combining multiple layers together to extract the information that I'm looking for. Now, there are various kinds of overlay operations that we can do. So what we want to look for when we are doing an overlay is whether we are looking for a common region, which is intersect, whether we want to combine two layers together, which could be union and other operations. So let's start with first the intersect. As the name suggests, we're looking for the common region between the two input layers. So for the intersect, we require two layers. One is, as you can see on the figure here, there's an input one having two polygons, A and B, and the intersect data layer, which is the second layer, having these four features. Now, if I just overlay this on top of this, you can see that the output contains more number of polygons or features compared to the input layers. But one observation that you can see is but what I'm getting is only the common region. And you can see that these portions are chopped off. The reason because is if we just put this on top of here, so only in the intersect we'll get the common region. So hence you can see these portions are chopped off. Other observation you see that again based on the principle of overlay. So if I consider this feature 4, which is created because of the intersection of this geometry along with the polygon feature 1 in the intersect data set. And if you happen to look closely to this attribute information, you'll see that the value for input 1 is B because this is lying within this region. And also the input 2 is 1 because it is lying in the first polygon or the first feature. Similarly, you can do it for the other polygons also. So important thing to remember is when I say intersect, we are looking for the common region. So which means all the extent will be the common region between the two input layers. And whatever we have learned from the principles of the overlay, that the new geometries are created, but also the attribute informations are inherited from the input. Now, intersect, you can use a various scenarios. For example, here we can understand that let's say there is a landslide has happened, and then we can find out how much damage that has happened to the vegetation. We can also find out what segments of roads has been damaged due to this landslide. So these are the various and other similar operations you can perform by using this intersect kind of an operation. Further, vector-based operation is the union. As the name suggests, we are trying to union the layers together. In this case, the example is given of land parcels and the soil types. So these are the two layers. So one is a land parcel having information about the land ownership and other details. And also the second layer is the soil types to describe the various types of soil. The moment we union them together, you can see that the output now not only contains the information of the land parcel, but also the information about the soil types in each land parcel. So again, remember the concept of the principle of the overlay operation, as we talked about in the previous slide. Wherever those polygons of the land parcels intersect with the soil types, you will see that these patches are created, wherein each land parcel, now apart from having the information about the ownerships and other details, also now contains the information about the soil. So again, individually, if you have looked at these two layers separately, so land parcel only contain information about the ownership and other details, whereas soil types contain the soil type details. But in case I want to find out what are the various soil types of soils in each land parcel, then I can union them together and then we can derive new information from the existing data, which in this case, I am trying to combine the land parcels with the soil. Now to understand this union operation, here we are taking the example of two objects, a purple object which contains features 1 and 2, and the yellow object which consists of a circle having the feature as 8. So now the moment I do this union operation compared to the intersect operation, the first thing you can observe is that in the intersect, we are only getting the common region. Whereas in the union, which is also called as an OR operation, whereas intersect will be your AND operation, common portion. we see that the extent or the output layer will be the combination of extent of the input and the input layer, both the input layer, let's say one and two, or the purple object and the yellow object. So the extent you can see is the combination of the input layer one and the input layer. And again, based on the principle of overlay, we can see that the output layer contains more number of features compared to the input layers. And also the attribute informations are inherited. So if we just consider this polygon, which is created because of overlaying a feature with the yellow object with the purple object, which in this case, this portion of the yellow object along with the second feature of the purple object. So this feature is created, but it also contains inherits the attributes from the both the layers. So you see that in the attribute information, the station value is 2 because this is coming under this region, and the type is A because this is coming from the yellow object, which is where the value for type is A. So union is again a very good operation that we can use when we want to combine multiple layers together to extract the information or to derive new information from the existing data sets. So just like we have seen in the previous slides, land parcel with soil types will give us information about the types of soils in each land parcel. Another operation that is very frequently used is called as a CLIP, or we also call it a cookie cutter operation. Now this requires the input feature, and also second input it requires is a cutter or a cookie cutter feature. So assume an example that you are given a road network of, let's say, our Uttarakhand region, and I'm only working on a part of Uttarakhand region. Then what I can do is I can clip or subset that region based on my boundary. Now here you see that there is no change in the geometry, there is no change in the attribute information. However, the output data is a subset of the existing data. So here the only those root segments which fall within my region are being derived in the output layer based on the, let's say, the extent or the cookie cutter layer that I have. One more analysis operation, apart from the clip, is called as erase, wherein we again provide two input. One is the input region, input layer, and second the erase feature. But the erase, as the name suggests, removes or masks out that portions from the input layer. So in the output, we get only the features apart from the erase feature, basically create that donut kind of a shape, as you can see here. Now you will have a doubt about the how we can differentiate between clip and erase. So we can understand why this example, given an input layer, we assume as a cookie dough, and a clip layer or cookie cutter layer. So clip just keeps whatever is inside this cookie cutter layer. So clip keeps the cookies and deletes the dough, whereas the erase keeps the dough, as you can see, but it deletes the portion that is given by this cookie cutter feature. Another way of putting it is this: clip extract features inside the boundary, whereas erase key features outside the boundary. So erase is primarily used when we want to remove certain portion or don't want to put the use in continuing our study region. Basically mask out those regions that we are not interested. So generally we use that erase operation to just remove it from our area of interest that we are working in. Now there are some other difference operations. So we can not only use the difference operation, let's say A minus B or B minus A, but we can also use the symmetric difference operation, which is like an XOR operation. As you can see from the input, it requires two layers. As you can see, the green and the yellow. And the output, you can see that it only puts those features which are in A or B, or should I say green and yellow, but not in both. So hence you can see that this portion has been created. So this can be used to find out the difference between the two features that has happened over a period of time. Another operation that people use is called a dissolve operation, wherein in this operation, you give the one input layer, and we pick the attributes. And the objective is to dissolve the boundaries of the adjacent pixel so I can get this outside. Now, let's say this could be useful when in various situations. One is, let's say you have the India state file and then you want to get the India boundary. Now, since you don't have the India boundary separately, but I do have the India state boundary, but if I can dissolve all the state boundaries, I will get the India boundary. And sometimes we also want to work not on the individual features, but in a, work them in a group. So let's say we have a land use denoting the residential and complex and commercial regions, but I don't want to see those individual parcels as commercial or a residential. So we can dissolve those regions so to see them as a whole instead of as a individual parcels or a piece of land. So dissolve operation is also very, very useful. One of the most widely used operation is the buffer operation, which is also called as a proximity analysis, wherein we provide the distance to create an elongated region or the area of influence around a selected features. It could be one feature or all the features. So we could create it on a point, we could create on a line, or we could also create on the. As I said, it is a very widely used a feature or a functionality in a GIS. So assume an example that the road denoted by the red color has to be extended, and then some of the shops or facilities which are coming because of the expansion of the road has to be taken into account so that those people could be relocated or some compensation could be provided. So what we can do is we can create a buffer around those roads, 60 meter on either side, and then we can find out all those establishments that will be affected if the road has to be expanded. But not only one region around the feature, we could also create multiple rings around the features, as you can see from the figure here. So given this road segment, we could create different buffer regions, let's say to denote the distance of between 0 to 100 meter, 100 to 200 meter, and 200 to 300 meter, which you also call as a multi-ring buffer. And this is also widely used because, let's say, we want to find out how many schools are accessible within the region of 100 to 200 meter from the road segment, from 100 to 200 meter, from 200 to 300 meter, and so. So not only one feature, we could also have this multiple rings of buffer where we want to see the multiple influences zones with the reference to the feature that we want to start. So up till now, we have talked about the various operations on the vector. We talked about the understood the concept of the vector overlay operation. And then we see the various operations like intersect, union, clip, erase, symmetric difference, dissolve, and also the buffer operation. Now let's get into and try to understand the various categories of operations that are available under the RISC raster data analysis. So please make a note, there are four types of categories of operations when we talk about the RISC raster data analysis, which are local, focal, zonal, and global. So first is a local, second is a focal, third is a zonal, and fourth is a global. Local, as the name suggests, is done on a cell-by-cell basis, whereas the focal, also called as a neighborhood operation, consider not only the cell under consideration, but also the neighborhood pixels in its vicinity. Zonal operations, compared to the local and the focal operations, consider a group of pixels as a zone and want to and performs the operation considering the zones as a one group of pixels. There's a global work on the entire raster data. Now we see one by one. First is the local operation. It is performed on a cell by cell basis. So you can see from here that this is a raster. So each cell, the operation will be performed wherein the output cell value will be a function of the input cell value. Now Not only this, the local can be performed on a single raster, but could also be done on multiple rasters. Now, one more thing that we should also understand is the concept of a no data bank. Now, these are cells that are in our raster for which we don't have the information or the information is missing. So this is a term for information provided to the GIS software to tell the system what to do with those kind of pixels where we don't have information. So generally, these are not included in the calculation. Now, there are tools to set the no data values, but generally, we set negative or very high values, which are not the valid values for our raster. Because zero, if you put as a no data, and zero happens to be a valid value in our input raster layer, will allow the system to exclude them from the operation. Generally, we keep as a very, some value which we don't expect to be in our input layer. We can put like minus 9999, something like that. Now, there are various examples of local operations. Popular examples are the overlay and the reclassification that we study in the subsequent slides. So let's first start with the local operations on a single raster. As I said, it is performed on a cell by cell basis. So we could say that the output raster is nothing but an algebraic expression that we have aligned on our input raster. And the operation that we could perform is could be arithmetic operations, could be relational logical operations, could be conditional, or could be the compound expression that we found by using the arithmetic and the relations or the logical operations. So various kinds of operations could be used like arithmetic, logarithm, trigonometry, power, and so on. One very simple example could be, let's say, given a dam where this number denotes 500 meter, 200 meter, 600 meter, like that. I want to add a value of 10 to each and every, the pixel value. So if you see that this pixel value, which is output of adding the value of 10 to the existing pixel value, so 5 plus 10 becomes 15, and so on. We can do it for the other pixel values in the raster. You could also use a more complex kind of an expression. Let's say given some slope raster, we want to convert it from percentage to a degree. So now this is our slope in degrees. We want to percentage, we want to convert into degrees. So what we can do is we can make use of this expression wherein for each pixel value, this expression will be applied based on the input pixel values in the layers, and the new output will be computed, which in this case is the conversion of slope raster from person to degree. Even your band math type of operations, let's say the computation of indices like NDVI, could also come some other local operations. Now, reclassification is very, very useful operation when you talk about working in a raster domain. As the name suggests, it is a process of reassigning the value or a range of values in a raster to the new output values. So assume that we are given some distance to road, a continuous raster, wherein each pixel denotes the how far it is from the nearest feature, in this case, the road. And these values are ranging from 0 to, let's say, 34,000 meters and above. We could reclassify them into different various preference layers. So we could say all the regions between 0 to 10,000 meters could be classified, could be reclassified as 1. And similarly, 10,000 to 20,000 is 2, and the rest as 3. So you can simplify them or assign them a new value based on the existing input value. So for this kind of operation, what we required is a lookup table, wherein we take the input raster, and then we provide the mapping between the old values and new values. In the output raster, the existing pixel values are replaced by the new values that we can provide using this raster reclassification table that is available. When you run this tool in any GIS software, you will provide a feature where you can enter the old values and the new values, and then the new raster output will be. So reclassification is generally used when you want to simplify the data, or maybe you want to replace the old existing value with the old value, and sometimes also used to maybe assign the new data values or put some pixel values under the new data values category. Or you want to do the grouping as we are doing it here, they're all, instead of understanding this raster as a individual pixel values or distances, we want to combine them into certain regions, let's say 1, 2, and 3 preference, and then based on that, we can do some weighted kind of an overlay. Not only in the continuous raster, we could also use reclassification on the discrete raster. For example, these are the land use values, and again, we are defining into different preference labels or suitability labels. So as you can see, the region of 21 marked in purple is being denoted as by 1. Similarly, if you look at this region, 22 is being marked as a no data values along with other regions. And as you can see from here, that 43 and also the 81. So 43, as you can see, this green part is being labeled as 3, whereas this 81 is being put as 2, and rest are all put as the no data values. So these kind of a reclassification also help, as I said, to give the divide them into groups or preference values, and we can use them later for our multi-criteria analysis or maybe the weighted overlay kind of an analysis. Now, the local operation could also be done on the multiple rasters, wherein the concept remains the same, but instead of working on a single raster, the map algebraic expression is applied on the two or more than two rasters. Again, the operators that we could use are arithmetic operations, operators, relational logical, and also some conditional or the combination of all the arithmetic and the relation in the logical operator. Again, important thing to remember is it is performed on a cell by cell basis, and there is no geometric calculation done, because for each pixel value of the first layer, the operation is performed on both the input layers, and we get an output pixel value wherein the condition is satisfied. If the condition is satisfied, that pixel will be represented by the necessary value. Let's say we are looking only for a Boolean value, 1 and 0 will be represented. So let's say our expression is, we are given a land use map. You only want to extract those land use type which are of type forest, and from the slope, you only want to extract those regions which are steep. So this will give you only those regions wherein both the conditions are satisfied, that is the pixel having a land use type of value of forest and slope as steep. So you'll get only these kinds of times. So this is an AND operation wherein only those pixels will come which satisfy both the condition, which is land use equal to forest and slope equal to steep. But as we have discussed, we could use other relation and logical operators also. So the overlay operation, we could, let's say, given this input raster A, denoting the elevation 500 meter, 200 meter, etc., and also this B, we could also perform various operations. It could be simply A plus B or some other complex expression that we can do. As I said, that your computation of indices are all come under the local operation. Now, talking about the logical expressions, you could also use those expressions to compute the new raster value depending on the input rasters that we are providing. And then we can make use of various operators, the logical operator. We can make use of the AND, wherein we get only those regions which are common in both the features, or, which is a union, where you get all the regions, or NOT, which is A minus B, or we could also make use of the XOR operation, which is a negation of our AND operation. So let's try to understand the simple expression first. So we are given a condition saying, given a input layer A and an input layer B. So the input layer A contains only the forest region and the non-forest regions. As you can see from the letter F, which stands for forest. Similarly, the layer B, you are given some numbers 4, 6, and 7, which denotes the elevation value of 4 means 400 meters, 6 means 600 meters, and 7 means 700. Now, given these two rasters of A and B, we want to find out only the regions wherein the value of A is forest in the input layer A, and the value or the elevation value in B should be less than 500. So now let's consider this pixel values and try to run this expression, because as I said, it is a local operation, will be done on cell by cell basis for all the regions. And output, as I said, will be a boolean. Something that is satisfied will be coming as 1, and rest will be 0. As you can see from this image, the white pixel denotes 0 values, or the false values. So if you look at this pixel, which is coming with output pixel value, output raster. If you consider this pixel, so this corresponding pixel is this in the input raster A, and in the B, the value is 4, which is 400. Now, if you consider these pixels with reference to layer 1 and layer 2, whether the value of A is forest in A, it is true. Is forest, it is true. Now, whether the value for B is less than 500, and the value for B is 400, which is less than 500, so this again becomes true. So 2 and true will be true. Hence, this value of this pixel has been labeled into the output. Similarly, if you consider this pixel, so let me clear this out. So now we are talking about this pixel here. So this corresponds to this pixel in the input layer 1, this pixel in input layer B. So whether the A is forest in this, no, this is non-forest. So this becomes false. And since it is an AND operation, both of the condition has to be true. Hence it is put as false in the output. So looking at this Venn diagrams, we can now do some other operations like AND, OR, or X. Now if I just consider this same pixels here that we have considered in the case of AND, and we see the working of the XOR operation, we see that the value for this was forest in the input layer 1, and the value was 4. So A equal to forest is true, and B is less than forest is also true. But since we are talking about an XOR operation, wherein only those regions appear which are in either in A or in B, not both. So both conditions should not be true. Hence, this pixel is not being coming under the true feature. It is shown in the false feature because we are making use of the XOR. And as I said, this AND, the XOR is a negation of your AND operation. That is another way of maybe understanding this expression. And then you can work around for the other also. The second category of operations is the neighborhood or the focal operation, wherein we are not only interested in the cell by cell, but we are also looking at the focal cell and also the neighborhood pixels of that surrounding that pixel. So here we are given this input raster, and then we first define the kernel or the window over which you want to perform to specify the neighborhood. That could be 3x3, 5x5, and so on. And then various statistics will be calculated. So in this case, we are showing the example of some statistics, wherein given this 3x3 window, so which is just simplified in the below figure, as you can see it here. So these values are represented here, and other values are discarded just for the, so that we can understand it better. Now we want to compute this central pixel value, and what we want to compute is the sum statistics. So the output comes here for this 3x3 window, S24. The reason being is, if you do the sum, which is 3 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1 plus 4, and we add the central pixel value, which is 5, so that comes around to be 24. And this window move across row by row till it finishes the entire. So all your convolution operation that you have studied in your first module comes under this focal operation, also called as a neighborhood operations. So again, compared to your local operation, which only talk about that particular cell, here we also talk about the cell and the adjoining region that we denote by this focal boundary. Now, Now, the third type of operation is called as the zonal operation. As the name suggests, it works with a group of cells of the same values or the similar features. Now, these groups are called zones. So, we could use a raster to denote those zones by giving all those pixel values, the similar values for those pixels to denote them as a zone. Now, one more thing is also important to note here is the zones may not need to be contiguous. They could be both contiguous or also the non-contiguous. So contiguous zone include the cells that are connected. However, non-contiguous zones include separate regions of cells. So there could be one portion here, but as long as the pixel value are same, those are considered as the non-contiguous groups. But the idea now in the zonal operation is here with this zonal operation requires two layers. One is a zone and second is our value raster. So the idea is, can we extract from the value raster some statistics based on our zone? So let's say given the watershed, we want to, and given the elevation or let's say the precipitation, we want to find out what is the maximum precipitation that happened in the watershed. But given this study region denoted by zone, we want to find the maximum elevation, minimum elevation, and so on. For given these zones and given this vegetation and different types of maps, we want to find out what are the various types of vegetation types that cover comes under this zone. So it is a quite a useful operation that people use. So as I said, it required a zone layer which defined the zone. So here you can make use of the raster as well as your let's say the shapefile kind of thing also to represent your zone features. But internally, those features will be converted to raster by the software. And also the second layer required is the value layer, which contains the input values for computing the zonal statistics. And the output contains the statistics that we are interested. It could be maximum, minimum, sum, range, majority, minority, and the type. But important thing to remember is that especially for the floating point raster, the measures like median, majority, minority, and variety will not be available for the floating point raster. Whereas rest are available for the integer. So the output of the zonal operation, there are various software provide an option of either converting, creating an output raster layer, or could also create a table wherein each row contains the static information with the, along with the information that we are extracting from the value raster. Now, one advantage of having a table is that you can use it for other purposes, or maybe let's say join back to the zone layer to extract, or maybe use in the subsequent operations. Or if you want, you can generate a new raster layer which contains the information about, let's say, the maximum elevation in those zones. The table, if you use the option of zonal operation output is the table, so each row in the table contains the statistics for the each zone. So let's say there are three zones, so there will be three records, let's say zone 1, 2, and 3, and whatever statistics will be in the attribute columns. So let's say majority, minority will all be there in those statistics in the individual columns. Now to understand it a little bit better, let's see some simple example. So this is a raster denoted by these pixels. So we have defined them into zones, let's say orange zones and blue zones. And then I have a value raster denoting these values. Now what we are looking for is the mean value. So if you look at these yellow pixels under these regions, the values is 5 + 5 + 3 + 2 + 5. So that comes around to be 20. And the number of pixels are 5. So 20 divided by 5 will be 4. Hence, you can see these four values are put in under the specific zone. Similarly, if you consider this blue pixels or the blue zones, again, we are looking for the mean value and we can compute the mean, and the values or the value will be replaced by the all the for each cell that is representing the zone in this zone raster. So basically the point is the zonal operation requires at least two layers, which is the zone layer and the value raster. So for the zone, you could use both raster as well as the vector, and the output layer, output again, you can have an option of getting as a raster layer, also as a table, tabular form that you can use for some subsequent operations. Now, the fourth type of operation in the raster is called as a global operation. And one of the very good example is the Euclidean distance. Given this road segment, what you want to find out is how far each pixel is from the nearest source. So what you see is like a buffered example denoting different regions, which denotes how far the pixels are from the nearest source. And as we have learned in the previous session, that we can also further reclassify them to define into different zones. So this gives us some continuous raster. So within our study region, we can find out how far the pixels are from different regions. As you can see from the colors here, so it ranges from this minimum value to the maximum value. So this is a good way of denoting the distance, continuum distance, when we talk about from the rasters. Now, there are various other operations that are available in GIS. So what we can, with the reference to the raster, we can do a clip, we can join multiple raster ties together, we can convert the floating point to the integer, or we can also extract certain portion of the raster either by attribute or by point or giving some polygon region. Now here I want to also emphasize that GIS could also be looked from different perspective. GIS, so the geographic information system, so S can stand for either the system, or we can also talk about the studies and also talk about the science. But one more way of looking at GIS is that it could also be looked in terms of series of tools. Just like every GIS every engineer has a set of toolbox which he carry, so similarly we could also look GIS as a set of tools that could be used in a typical workflow to get to process the data or get the desired result from the input pipeline from A, let's say from all the stages from the pre-processing to the final stage. So GIS could also be looked in terms of a set of tools wherein these could be available in various GIS softwares, either in the form of tools. So you will come across a terms like toolboxes, both in a proprietary like ArcGIS and also in the QGIS kind of environment. So this is an example of extraction. So let's say given a raster and the mask layer only gives us those portions which are within those regions. Rest are all marked as no data values. Similarly, given a point or a polygon, or a, let's say here, this we are giving some circular shape to extract based on the circular region. So what I get is only those pixel values which are within this region. Rest are all put as the data value. Now there are various other kinds of tools that are available. So as I said, GIS could be looked in from the tools perspective. There are different types of tools are available. So depending on somebody who's working on, let's say the terrain analysis, will find certain tools related to finding the slope, the aspects, or given and then they want to convert into the content. But if you look at closely, they will somehow fit into one of those the types of raster operation that I've discussed. For example, again, the slope, and find the steepest value with reference to the region. So this will come under our focal operation where we define the window, and then we are looking for with reference to the pixel value, where is the steepest value, and then we assign those values to that the gradient to that slope. Similarly, we can also find the aspect, which is the direction in which that slope is facing. And then there are other series of tools that we can use for, let's say, given and then we can extract the contours and other kind of information. And also, again, maybe just one more point that I want to tell about is that GIS comes with a very big set of functionalities, but we can't cover all. So as I said, GIS also talks about, and I was mentioning about the S in the GIS is study. So GIS could be used for crime analysis, or let's say for watershed studies, for elevation studies. So depending on the use cases, people use these different tools to get to the. One of the other concepts that will come across in GIS is the concept of a map algebra, wherein kind of a calculator is provided where we can write different operations, just like we do algebraic expression on the different values. We can also do a map algebra, where in this case the input layers or the map or the raster, and we provide some algebraic expressions to compute the new information given the algebraic expression. And this is primarily done by a tool that is available, something called as a raster calculator. So wherein you can define your input layers will be available, and then we can write an algebraic expression to get the output plot. So let's say given here the dem value, I only want those regions which are above 2000 feet. So I can just write this expression, and the output will be again true or false values. So these calculators are available both in the proprietary, let's say this is the example of ArcMap, and this is QGIS, wherein you get an output in the form of a binary, which is a true or false value. So assuming that you don't have some kind of tools already available, you can make use of these calculators to run your own complex equations, or let's say the algebraic expressions that you want to write with a reference to your raster layers. Now the last topic that I want to cover is I want to highlight some of the comparisons of vector and raster based analysis operation. Because now the thought will be coming to your mind is that I can work on raster, I can work on vector, but what are the considerations to keep in mind while working on them, and which one to choose? Now, what we know is that vector and raster data analysis are the two types of GIS analysis, depending on the data models that are available in GIS, which is the vector and the raster. Now, mostly they are treated separately because GIS software traditionally can't run them together in the same operations. But however, there are tools that are provided by the GIS to convert either from vector to the raster or the raster to the vector back. Now, there are certain operations that allows the use of vector data in some raster operation, as we just mentioned, the extraction operation, but internally the software do convert them into the same format before it starts the operation. So that we have to also keep in mind. Now, each project that we do under a GIS is completely different in terms of the data sources and objective. So the choice sometimes generally earlier used to depend on the type of software we have, but nowadays it is mostly depend on the type of analysis that we want to perform, considering the efficiency and also the appropriate data that we have. So ultimately it boils down to the availability of data, whether we already have the data in raster format or the vector format. And earlier, as I said, it was dependent purely on the software, because earlier the software were used to work either on the vector or in the raster. But the other thing to also consider is the complexity and the efficiency of the results that we are getting. Now, this again, I want you to relate and maybe recall what you have learned during the difference between the raster and the vector structures. So we talk about raster as a simple data structure, whereas the vector as a complex. We also talk about that raster, the image processing kind of operations are more easily handled than compared to the. And also the operations are much faster in the raster compared to the vector, considering those complex geometries that has to be taken. With this background, I want to just cover two different operations, and then we'll try to understand the differences between them. So the first operation that I'm considering is an overlay operation. And I'm putting that the local operation with multiple rasters can be compared to the vector overlay operation that we have seen. So the overlay of a vector can be compared to the local operation where we do the cell by cell operation to compute the output raster. But now let's try to understand the differences that we exist when we do this in vector and raster. Based on our principles of vector overlay, what we have studied is wherever there was an intersection between the features, the new points or geometries were created at those intersections. However, this is not required for the raster-based cell operations, because the cell size and the extents are same. Even if the cell size are not same, we can do the resampling as a pre-processing step before we perform those operations. But looking from the computation perspective, this is less complicated than calculating the line intersection, building of the topology, inheriting of the attributes, and so on. Now, other thing to also observe based on the whatever we have covered in this lecture was that raster-based local operation, we can use various tools that could be our arithmetic operations, logical operation, or the combination of this to create an output. There is in the vector overlay, what we primarily do is the new intersectional geometries are there and the attributes are combined, but we can't perform any operation on the attributes. So that is a separate step that we do after the overlay operation has been done. Now talking about the raster overlay, it is preferred for projects where we have a large number of layers and those takes a lot of time for the computation, because we say raster are faster, but they are faster in the sense that we are performing on a cell by cell basis, so we'll be able to compute in a less amount of time. But the good thing about also from the vector perspective, it allows us not only to combine multiple attributes together. If you remember when I talk about the vector principle, we are having the ID, cost values, were inherited, also the class values. Once the output layer is created in the vector mode, we not only have those geometries, but the attributes are there. And then based on that attributes, we can do some various kinds of queries, either by combining them or individually, unlike the raster, wherein each pixel generally have only one output. That is something of a benefit when we are working on the vector. Now, the second operation that I want to talk about is the buffer. So now we can assume that that the vector-based buffering and the raster distance or the Euclidean distance that I talk about can be compared, because these both represent a kind of feature elongated region or distances with reference to the features. But again, now relate back to the what you have learned on the vector data model and the raster, that for each vector feature, the XY update are specifically stored. Whereas for the raster, we are given a top left and then we compute the other cell values. Now, other thing to notice here is the buffering uses the coordinates in measuring the distances. Whereas in raster, we are limited using the cell as a size. So even if let's say 100 meter and the cell is more than that, even it occupies one half of it, the whole pixel will be. So the point I want to convey here is the buffering can be more accurate, zones could be created than the raster based operations, because in raster we are limited by the resolution of the cell sizes. So where the accuracy is very, very important, then the vector or those kind of distances are more important. Let's say you want to implement the riparian zone kind of a thing, so denote the difference or region from the water and the other regions. Another good thing about buffering, if you note, observe it closely, which I talked about in this lecture also, is that we could create multiple rings or multiple zones of buffers. So we were not able to see this elongated feature around a road, but we could have multiple rings around them. So let's say a region of 100 to 0 to 100 meter, 100 to 200 meter, and maybe 200 to 300 meter. Whereas raster just generally creates a continuous distance measure, as we can see it from here. We can define the maximum distance to reach, or we can restrict it to the based on the extent. That is what we can do. So once our this distance is created, what we can do is we can do a data processing or reclassification to define them into different zones or put them into suitability indexes or ranges, let's say 1, 2, and 3, to denote the highly suitable to the least suitable. Now, other advantage of a buffer is that it allows us to create the separate buffer zones for each feature. I mean, please note that it's saying separate zones for each select feature. As you can see, it allows us to create a separate zones around each features, and we also can dissolve, which we have learned one of the operation in GIS, to not only see the individual features, but group of features as a whole. Now, these things are difficult to create and manipulate the separate distance measures using the raster based approach. So these, with this two examples, I just want to bring the point that you please also always remember these things when you are working on some of those tools constrain the vector and the raster based operations. So in this session, we talked about, I started by the quick recap of the data models, the process flow, where I emphasize that the GIS process start with the defining of the problem, maybe laying down the criteria based on which we import or create data, wherein a lot of effort has been gone. And once our database is created, The actual power of GIS comes into the picture where you perform, use the capability of GIS to perform the analysis, which we call it the spatial analysis. Spatial analysis could be defined as computing new information from the existing stored data to get an insight from the data. But anytime we are trying to relate one feature with another, or seeing one feature in relation to the other, as I talk about the example of the Jon Snow cholera map, where he was trying to relate the water pump with the cholera. Now, the other way of looking at the types of operations could be that we have a simple measurement retrieval function. We could also have the overlay function that we talked about, and also the neighbor. Now, when you come to the vector-based overlay operations, the various operations are intersect, union, flip, erase, symmetric difference, dissolve, and the very important is the buffer operation. When you come to the vector, the raster-based operations, we could define them under four categories, which are local or a cell by cell, focal, the cell and the nearest neighborhood region or pixels. Third is the zonal, wherein we denote a group of pixels to and work on them as a zone instead of working as a cell by cell or a cell in the region. And fourth is the global operation, which works on the entire raster. The example is the Euclidean distribution. Later, finally, I also discuss about the consideration to keep in mind while working on the raster and vector, and we have discussed two examples of overlay and buffer. So with this, I close. I thank you for the patient listening, and I wait for your questions. Thank you.